Hey guys, we are in the basement, and today, guys, we are gonna do a John's Arcade on the road. And yes, this is part number two of our 2015 Chicago Arcade Adventure Series with Greg from Arcade Impossible. And if you guys missed part number one, please go back and watch it because it was a lot of fun. You know, we went to Logan Arcade or Logan Hardware, which is an amazing arcade with a super cool owner. And then also in the last video, we ate a lot of food. Yes, we had a lot of Chicago food. So if you guys want to see some really good food and an awesome arcade, go back and watch part number one. But anyway, this is part number two, and again, we're gonna hook up with Greg from Arcade Impossible. But what we're gonna do in this video is pretty amazing. It's absolutely amazing, guys. We are gonna take an all-access tour of the Stern Pinball Factory in Elk Grove, Illinois. Yes, Stern, you know, the world's largest manufacturers of pinball machines. You know, these are the guys making Game of Thrones and Spider-Man and AC/DC, Metallica, Lord of the Rings. I used to have the Simpsons Pinball Party down here. And so in this video, we're gonna go to their factory and we're gonna see everything, guys. We're gonna see exactly how pinball machines are made. And what's even more amazing about this is our tour guide is going to be George Gomez. Yes, famed designer and one of my heroes, George Gomez. You know, George made NBA Fast Break right there. He made Revenge from Mars, he did Tron, Spy Hunter, Lord of the Rings. This guy has done so many amazing games, and he's the one that's gonna show us around, and it is so awesome. So anyway, we're gonna go to the Stern Pinball Factory, take an all-access tour, and then of course, you know, we're in Chicago, we're gonna have to get some more food. and then we'll come back to the basement and do viewer mail. But before we go though, I have to tell you guys something. You guys remember Ian Kellogg? He's got a website, iankellogg.com. Ian is an electrical engineer. He puts together cap kits and rebuild kits for power supplies. Ian actually helped me get that quantum cabinet here from Pittsburgh. Ian helped me with my iRobot power supply. He put together a rebuild kit. But anyway, Ian's an awesome guy, really honest, and him and I are gonna be kind of working together going forward. And actually, here's a little sneak peek of what we're doing, okay? And we're not quite ready to announce this or even have these for sale yet, but we're gonna be having some John's Arcade branded super deluxe kits. And these will be super deluxe rebuild kits with some parts you wouldn't normally find in rebuild kits, like, you know, like B plus power supplies. And it'll come with stickers and just, you know, the highest quality parts that will just last forever. And these will be for sale soon on Ian's website at iankellogg.com. But for now, Ian wanted me to share with you guys a code for John's Arcade viewers. If you go to his website at iankellogg.com, starting tomorrow, November 30th, which is Cyber Monday, you know, the biggest online shopping day of the year. If you go there and you use the code Cyber John Day, yes, Cyber John Day, starting tomorrow, November 30th, 2015, all the way until Friday, December 4th, I believe it is, that whole week, Monday through Friday, go there and use the code Cyber John Day. You will get 20% off your entire order. So if you guys want to stock up on cap kits, here's your chance. Go to iankellogg.com. Enter the code CyberJohnDay and get 20% off your entire order. Yeah, you guys can order like 30 cap kits, and 20% off is gonna add up. So anyway, iankellogg.com. And by the way, he really does use the best components, and he knows what he's doing. He's an electrical engineer. He's a pretty smart dude. So iankellogg.com, CyberJohnDay is the code. 20% off November 30th through December 4th. All right, guys, enough of that. Let's get in the car. We're gonna drive to Chicago, Illinois, hook up with Greg from Arcade Impossible, and let's go take a tour of the Stern Pinball Factory in Elk Grove, Illinois. So we're here at Stern, Greg.
We're here.
Look, here's a sign right here. It says Stern Pinball.
Stern Pinball.
So it's a pretty, what do you think? Is this what you imagined
this
it would look
nice.
Like?
Like actually, it, you know, pictured more brown.
More brown.
A bit of glass and everything.
It
looks corporate and warehouse in one.
Right, and you can see there's a play field there. Maybe we'll get to see some top secret game.
Oh, that would be nice.
So, all right, so we're gonna wait for John, who's gonna show us around, and then see what's going on in there.
Very cool.
All right, thanks
good
for doing this.
Guys, no problem. Hey there.
It's Greg. Sorry.
Hey guys.
This is Mark and Matt.
Hi, Mark.
Morning, guys. All right, guys. So we're in the production facility. Is that?
Yeah. You're at Stern Pinball.
That's right.
And largest this pinball company in the world.
Yes.
And our brand new Elk Grove Village facility, which is 110,000 square feet.
That's crazy. That's big.
Yeah.
And so, if you guys don't know, this is George Gomez, and you've heard me mention his name many times on the videos, because I have NBA Fast Break, I have
awesome.
Revenge from Mars,
awesome.
I had Disc of Tron,
awesome.
I have Tron. I've got a lot of your stuff.
Of my stuff.
I'm a fan.
Well, thank you.
Yes. And so we have the honor of having George show us around. I mean, it doesn't get any better than this.
I'll see if I can make it fun for you. I consider myself really blessed to have spent my career, working and
making
games.
Fun.
Yeah, making fun,
right?
Toys and video games,
yep.
And pinball machines. And so, today I run the product development group for Stern Pinball, executive vice president of game development, which means all the product development efforts report up to me. And I'm trying to grow the company and take it in directions where it hasn't yet been. We've had a lot of luck in the last few years that we've created a lot of compelling product and people have really responded to the stuff we've done. And so we're just gonna kind of keep that ball rolling.
Right. And so what we're gonna see, what's in production right now?
Right, so one of the most amazing things about Stern Pinball is that on any given week, we'll be producing different product. So we come in and out of product. The facility is really incredible in that they can repopulate the work cells, restock for a different game, and be up and building it. So typically we're running two, sometimes, we might be running as many as four and getting ready to stage another game.
Mm-hmm.
So four different titles, we have two main lines and there'll be two titles running on those lines and then there may be two titles getting ready to run. So you'll see bits and pieces of those titles
right.
in the sub-assembly area.
Gotcha.
So we're gonna show you, we'll just show you around and
cool.
Walk around.
So you're
cool.
Always producing.
Always producing.
There's never downtime.
There may be downtime if we're waiting on material for something.
Yeah.
But the procurement guys are great.
And right.
The vendor base is awesome. If we have a couple hundred people here, we'll have as many as 300 people in the building stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But our extended vendor base is a couple thousand people. So because you have to think about the thousands of people that, like, our steel vendors, our plastic vendors,
right.
That are making material that comes in here that then gets integrated and assembled into
right.
the games. So we're very, very proud of being an American manufacturer, and we literally create employment for thousands of people.
That's awesome.
So it's a very cool thing. And when we take you back, I'm going to show you one of my favorite things about Stern Pinball, and that is that, we see the games come out of our heads, onto our computers, we work them, et cetera. And then in the back, you'll see boxes that are labeled, and they're going all over the world. So you'll see, Dubai, you'll see, Russia, you'll see all these places.
Right.
And that's a really exciting thing, that the games are American made, yet they're going all over the world.
All over the world.
Yeah.
Very cool. All right, well, show us around.
All right, so this is basically just a cafeteria. This is where the workforce eats.
Right. Lots of microwaves.
Yeah, because everybody.
That's the most microwaves
and
I've ever seen.
In the forums, there's a lot of conversation about our microphone.
Is that really?
So, yeah. They can never understand, but it's like they need to be here in the facility when the entire factory invades this area.
Right.
Everybody's trying to heat their lunch.
Right.
They have a certain amount of time to eat.
Right. So, makes sense. Otherwise, you'd be weak.
So, but there's all this speculation. What do they do with the microwaves?
Right.
So we've had a lot of fun. Like a lot of times, we've gone back there and we've put toys, like from the pinball.
Yeah.
Inside the microwave, just put the pictures up.
Yeah, like you're testing them or something.
Right. We're not doing anything. What do we do in the microwave? We heat food.
Right.
So this is sort of the internal arcade.
And
this is all these changes. And when the games come out of product development, a lot of the very, very initial testing that happens outside of product development begins to happen here, because a lot of the people in the factory have access to it, and guys come in and out of here and play all the time.
Right.
So
it's cool. You have the original KISS. Was that kind of used for reference?
Yes.
Right.
Yes. I mean, that is the first game that Stern Pinball ever made. That Laser Wars.
Is that right?
Back then, yeah. Back
that's
when
it.
It was Data East.
That's the game.
Yeah, that's the game. Well,
it's not
this
the
particular game.
Yeah.
But this title.
That title. Okay.
Yeah. Back when Gary started Data East Pinball.
Yeah.
This was their first title.
Okay. Cool. And then Data East morphed into Sega. Is that what happened?
Yeah.
Or?
Yeah. Gary originally got funding from Data East.
Okay.
To start a pinball company.
Okay.
At some point in time, Data East and Sega had a relationship.
Okay.
And Sega transferred the assets over to Sega.
I see.
And then eventually Gary bought it outright from Sega.
And then renamed it Stern.
That's correct.
Right.
And the very, very original, company.
His father had the original Stern.
Right. And his father was part owner of the original Williams.
Okay. So, interesting.
Yeah. His father was an operator, as you'll see, if you go to our Facebook page or our website, you'll see this. His father was an operator.
Okay.
And, the legend has it, he had a meeting with Harry Williams and he offered to buy, part of Harry's company or the company from Harry. And Harry went out, Harry had a private plane and he went up and flew around Chicago for a couple of hours and landed.
It
and
said
came back
no.
And said okay.
Oh, he did. It said okay.
Yeah.
That's funny.
So, here, let's go over here.
Yep.
So these are play fields.
Awesome.
You can see we're building. Medieval Madness product, right? These are play fields getting ready to go on.
And these are printed off-site, right?
Yes. Yeah.
And
so they're machined and printed and hard coded off-site.
It's not silkscreen anymore, is it? Is it a four color process?
So it is.
Okay.
It is silkscreen.
Oh,
it is. Four color process, and it is silkscreen.
Is it like a heat transfer?
No. And it is not. It's traditional silkscreening.
Okay.
But it is four color process. Depending on the games, like for example, some games we may do old school where every pass is a color.
Yeah.
Or it's, CMYK.
Right.
And so, yeah. Yep. And so like here you have, some of, here's our Medieval Madness, or I'm sorry, here's our Game of Thrones.
Okay.
And so these are Game of Thrones getting ready to go. You'll see over here you've got more Game of Thrones.
And these jigs here, these are to put all the...
I'll show you in a second.
...to populate it? Okay.
Yeah. So here's some Iron Man.
Oh, that's cool.
And what do we have here? Some KISS. So remember what I said, at any given point in time, if there's demand from the marketplace, we will produce it.
I see. So you'll revisit something this and repopulate...
Absolutely. Yep. We never... A game is only ever over if the customer base
doesn't want it. Right.
Yeah, doesn't want it, right? So one of the things that happens is Roberto sees these games first.
Mm-hmm.
And his job is to essentially look over every play field. This is probably the third or fourth time that every play field has been looked over.
Is that right?
Yeah. So they get looked over at the vendor, and then when they come in here, they get looked over again. So he'll look at them. If anything looks suspicious to him or an issue, he'll put it aside.
I see.
Then the play fields start running down the line. These guys.
And this is where they put the inserts and stuff in?
Well,
or?
No, so these guys are, those are called drill plates.
Okay.
And so he puts down the drill plate. These are holes that for one reason or another, do not get put in as part of the CNC routing process.
I see.
Usually, it's because there are certain size that where they would take a much longer time to do on the CNC, or the drill bits would break all the time on CNC. And so
they manually come in here with tool. Yeah.
He'll come in. Those are essentially drill bushings, and he's going in. Every one of those drill bushings has drill stop, so he only goes as far as he has to.
Gotcha.
And he's going in and grabbing all these holes.
Wow. So there's still a lot of manual labor.
Oh yeah.
Tons of manual labor.
So these guys, these guys are essentially, again, doing operations. They're starting to put T-nuts in them.
Mm-hmm.
T-nuts are threaded nuts that allow the fasteners to come in and hold things. Let's go down here.
The die.
So this machine, particular press, dates back to Gottlieb days.
Is that right?
Gottlieb Pinball Company. And this particular press has pressed every Stern Pinball, Data East, and Sega Pinball.
Is that right?
Yeah. Game.
So you could never get rid of this. It's a good luck.
So what this does is it spots the locations for wood screws, top and bottom.
Okay.
That's what this plate is. So that plate, see these pins?
Yep.
They're real sharp. And those pins essentially make a mark on the wood.
Gotcha.
So that the operator knows where he's putting
right.
the screw.
So it's kind of starting the screw hole.
Right, these are wood screw marking holes.
Gotcha. And they go in that deep, that quarter inch?
They'll go in, but you see this only compresses so much.
I see, so just a little dimple on there.
Yeah. Just a little dimple.
Gotcha.
Right. You see over here, so this is a staging area for different material.
Mm-hmm.
So like you'll see, like wood rails, some of the ball guides.
Yep.
Now we're going into the sub-assembly areas. So the sub-assembly areas make all the small self-contained assemblies that go on the game.
Okay.
So a gadget, a device, a mechanism, all a toy, they'll all be assembled here. And the main lines are on either side. We'll see those in a minute.
Okay.
And so the parts go from the sub-assembly area, and they'll feed, they feed either line.
I see.
So you see an assembly line over there, there's an assembly line over there. And so each one of these sub-assembly areas basically creates something, like for example, here's some auto launch assemblies, mm-hmm. right?
Yep.
And so these are all staged right here in boxes.
Gotcha.
Right?
And they take the components of that and put it together.
They'll take all the components.
Yep.
See right here, you'll see all the bits and pieces that make up that assembly.
Right.
Right? And then, once she's done assembling them, here you see springs and all the different parts. She's got her tools are all set up. All the tools are labeled. The torque settings are adjusted. There's a guy that sweeps the line on a regular basis, makes sure that all the tools are correct.
Right.
Everything's set properly. And so when she's sitting here, here's coils as they come in from, from our vendors.
Yep.
And so she does basically puts the entire thing together here and then puts them in the boxes, and the boxes get distributed out to the line. Here's more, here's another mechanism, it's a post. Here's some ball guides that get some.
It's cool.
He's awesome.
These ball guides that get some optos on them, this is just how they manage to get them to the line, and after that, they'll go on to the game. You'll see that in a second. Some raw material coming in. Here's these
apron.
Are bottom. Yeah,
yeah,
these are aprons, bottom arches. Powder coated and they're covered in this foam so they don't get damaged.
Right.
So they go in nice. They're all staggered.
Is that a universal part for all the games? They all use that same one?
No. We change the color all the time.
Oh, okay.
Sometimes designers put holes in them.
Oh.
They light them and stuff. So one of the things she's doing right here, she's stripping the protective material off of these stainless steel ball guides.
Right.
So stainless steel is used in either decorative locations, it's also used in durability locations.
Okay.
So anything that has to be certain, sometimes it's a functional need, like it needs the part needs to be very tough, the ball comes in contact with it. And sometimes it's just decorative, it's above the play field, we really want to show it off.
Right. So they all ship with these protective
They come from the vendor. You know, this is how they come from the vendor with, you know, with a protective layer of plastic on them.
Yeah.
Right? And so
yeah, take it off.
Yep.
Let's see here. Let's go over here.
These mini playfields?
Yeah. These are Game of Thrones mini playfields. And you know, she's putting them together. You see
that's
the picture
cool.
that she uses here. It's all
right.
protected to protect the play field, so she puts it in upside down and she works it.
So that's concerned all the way through, right? Getting scratches and dings on the...
We try really hard.
Yeah.
We try really hard to protect them.
Yeah.
We're not perfect.
Right.
Sometimes, you know, sometimes we let something out.
Right.
We make a lot of games.
Right, right.
So you see them again in the pictures, and she's using the tools. And so, you know, she'll start it, she'll add something to it.
Gotcha.
Let's see,
the scale of this is massive.
Yeah.
One of the most famous
target?
Mechanisms in pinball.
Yeah.
Right? Drop target bank. You see lots of...
So how often do you need to reinvent the wheel when you're developing a game? Like, you know, like a drop target bank, does that just get used like over and over?
Right. So things like drop targets, pop bumpers,
right.
and slingshots and flippers come out of the inventory.
Right.
Right. So it's sort of the standard toy box that a designer has to work with.
Right.
But I think that on any given game, probably if you include the cabinet, which we consider the platform,
right.
the system platform, you include the cabinet and the base electronic system, you probably only have 35% of the parts in a game that are common game to game.
Right, right,
the
okay.
The rest of the stuff is all custom to the game.
Okay.
Right, so every ball guide, occasionally there's, you know, like if a designer is familiar, it's very common for designers to reuse their own stuff.
Yeah.
Right, so like, I've used this, you know, I know this ramp, I've used it before, it's like the entrance ramp into the playfield. You know, it's a common detail, a lot of guys use it.
Right.
That might be, you
might
know,
get
a
reused.
Piece that's common.
Right.
Right. But almost everything else a designer's doing custom. So here you have dragons getting put together. Here's some finished dragon assemblies.
That's cool.
So all of this stuff is stuff that we designed. I actually did this little...
Did you really?
Yeah, I did the mechanism that flaps his wings because the, you know, with one of the engineers, the team was kind of hammered, and so I thought I'd help out.
Yeah,
and so I
that's
did
cool.
some of this stuff.
And then the injection molding, that's done off-site, right?
Yep,
okay.
Yep, but it's all our designs.
Yeah.
So we will essentially, like, this part came about in our computers.
Yep.
And
the spray masking's all off-site.
Everything off-site,
yeah.
Right
okay.
from the vendor.
Yep.
And here you see Dragon's in partial state of assembly, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, this is, you know, he's getting the... he just has the LED in his mouth and the cable, and...
That's awesome. I love that thing. And who did like the sculpt?
Yeah, so the sculpt we started out with the actual Game of Thrones CG model.
Okay.
And it wasn't quite what we needed.
Yeah.
So then our sculptors, you know, took it and modified it
to work for your purpose.
Yep,
yeah.
Yep,
okay.
Yep.
Cool.
More mechanisms, you know, you can see.
So these days doing pinball machines, like how is it compared to back in the 90s with like style guides and assets? Is there more stuff now?
Well, so it's very dependent on the license.
Okay.
Some licensors have very tight style guides.
Yeah.
With a lot of detail.
Mm-hmm.
And some licensors have less of a style guide.
Okay.
And less
assets. It just depends, right.
So it really depends on what you're working on.
Yeah, yeah.
Sometimes if we can find something, like we can find a toy on the shelf that works for us and we can find enough of them and we can do a deal, we'll do that.
Right.
more often than not, we end up making our own stuff.
Gotcha.
The biggest difference back then, we did almost everything was hand sculpted.
Mm-hmm.
We still do some handwork, but almost everything, almost everything now is digital. So
right.
we do a lot of digital sculpting in our CAD tools.
Mm-hmm.
That's when you say back in the day, we had a lot of the same stuff in the game.
Right.
We were just doing it a little bit differently.
A little more, yeah.
So you can see troughs, and you can see there's part of the main line.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, for example,
oh, okay.
see these cables are going, these cables are all labeled Game right. of Thrones, General Illumination.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Some, different Game of Thrones cables. And so she's laying them on here. These girls, you see,
yep.
see with all the vent hoods, these are all soldering stations.
Gotcha.
Right, so we still do a lot, an awful lot of hand soldering. We've done lots of testing, and the hand soldering, as labor intensive as it is also incredibly durable.
Right.
And so it's very susceptible to vibration. The games get a tremendous amount of vibration.
Right.
They get vibration in all kinds of weird frequencies that are somewhat difficult to predict. And so the hand soldering really helps us a lot.
It does.
Yep.
Interesting. That's cool.
You see here some... this is a partial assembly. This is for the pro game. And you can see this is the mechanism that flaps and moves the dragon back.
That's awesome.
And so you can see, still see the protective plastic on the laser cutter, laser cut plastics. And the mechanism, all this stuff is designed in-house.
That's awesome.
Yep.
That's so cool. And you came up with this mechanism.
Yeah, I just did this. I just did the little cam and lever that.
Mm-hmm.
That
that's cool.
Sometimes, it's not actually in my job description anymore.
Right, right.
But
you must get off on it, though.
Team, I do. I like it. I right. like it. I love it. If a design team is hammered, which they usually are,
yeah.
They're like up to the ears and stuff.
Right.
And some designers, because of my toy background, some designers like to work with me on the
right.
toy. So even if I don't go all the way through with something, they'll come see me. Steve Ritchie, some of these guys will come see me and say, hey, what do you think? What do you think we could do with this, or how do we do this? And
right.
what do you think about that? And so we'll just sit down
and brainstorm.
And say, what about this? And in that particular case, it was really significant that it be as small as it could be. We had some restraint. We had some constraints relative to the fact that it was going to be used on the mini play field and on the pro game in a different location. And so we had to come up with a mechanism that was sort of somewhat flexible that could
right.
sort
do,
of
do both.
Both.
Yeah.
Yeah. With some minor changes. And so not a lot different from, I think, designing anything. The car guys, they'll share a transmission across several models.
Right.
And we'll do the same.
Yep.
Yeah.
So Greg, what do you think of this?
This is I'm overwhelmed.
Is it everything awesome. You dreamed of?
Yeah.
Some ramps. These are ramps as they come in from the vendor. This is clear vacuum form PETG.
Mm-hmm.
PETG is a really tough plastic
mm-hmm.
that lends itself to the application. And so they'll come in, they'll come in from the vendor like this, and then they'll go into the sub-assembly areas and they'll start getting put together. So, here's some ramps in different, here's that same ramp, only now it's had some plastics added to it, it's had a decal, it's had, some lamps and all that stuff, some optos,
mm-hmm.
the opto interrupters, it sensed the ball. So those, by the way, are Star Trek ramps, so that, to me, says we're
right,
building
back
more
in.
Star Trek. Let's see, you can see lots of Game of Thrones stuff, because obviously, that's what we're doing today. And some medieval madness stuff.
Cool.
Right? So
the drawbridge?
Yep, the drawbridge mech.
So you guys are assembling this for Chicago Pinball, is that
that's
right?
That's correct. Yep,
okay.
Yep.
And they just contracted
Chicago Pinball. also happens to be, you know, Churchill Cabinet. So we have a long-standing relationship with them. They fabricate our raw play fields. Mm-hmm. You know, they machine our raw play fields and finish them and hard coat them. And the same thing with our cabinets. And so when they said they were going to go into make this limited run of, you know, of remakes, we said, well, you know, we can help you out.
Right.
We know how to build pinball machines.
Right.
A bunch of us actually worked on that game back
exactly.
in the day. So we said, okay, well, you know, I worked on bits and pieces of that castle to make it blow up, and so it's stuff that I remember.
Right.
So when they were like, you know, they were, and of course Lyman Sheets was the programmer on the game, and
yep.
so when they were trying to get into some of the stuff they were doing, you know, that we acted as a resource.
Right. And what do you think of that, revisiting that title, bringing it back?
Well, you know, I think it's great. I think that those mm-hmm. titles are in demand.
Right. And there's rumors of maybe Attack from Mars or Monster Bash.
Yeah, there is.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I think that if they do well with this and it works out, then, you know, I think that some of that stuff is possible.
Yeah, that's cool. Monster Bash would have a licensing little snafu though, right?
Yeah, but maybe not.
Maybe not?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's a deal to be done.
Yeah.
So, you know, we're about to go into the final test area where play fields are basically tested. And so the way this works is that the play fields go into the racks, and the guys working on them are a combination technician and tester.
Okay.
And so there's a series of things that they will do, but they'll go through 100% of the play field. And then the play fields will get married to cabinets, and then the process will take place once again. So someone will test everything that these guys have tested on the racks. There's a series of adjustments that they do. They're very, very talented.
Hmm.
So here you see them on the racks, and you can see we've got a Star Trek, and, you know, we've come over here, let's see what we got, and another Star Trek.
Is the hardware that they're using, is it generic, or is it...
Right. It's
just fire coil.
Yeah.
Like that kind of stuff.
Well, they'll go through the entire menu.
Yeah.
Check every switch, every coil, every mechanism. Then there's a series of adjustments that they'll make. And then, you know, they'll basically test it against the production code.
Okay.
So they'll do a variety of functional tests against the production code. And then they'll get married to the games, and once they're married to the games, they'll get tested again.
Hmm.
So, but you can see, so obviously we're building Star Trek. More Star Treks. More Star Trek. And then I would guess that since I see some Game of Thrones, I see all Star Treks coming down this line. There's probably Medievals on that line.
Yeah.
So I bet you later on in the week you come down here, there will be Game of Thrones on the line. Around in the final area.
Mike, you should get a shot of this. This is cool. This looks awesome. It's like that Enterprise.
Right, I did that too.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I did these models. The model that we got from from the movie company really wasn't producible.
Okay.
It was a model that's functional for their use, you know, but it was essentially a polygonal model. And when they do a polygonal model, they don't, because nobody has to make their stuff for real. None of that stuff is watertight. You can't print it. You can't do anything
right.
with it, you know.
It just renders on the screen.
Yeah, it just renders on the screen. It looks pretty, but I mean, it's like parts floating in space.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, okay.
Just sort of made it to each other, but floating in space. So, not something that any machine in the real world
could actually print.
Yeah,
right.
Could actually print. So,
so you kind of simplified
so
it for production.
I took it, and I started by trying to work with their model, and then it was just so much work that I said, screw it, I'm going to make a new one. So I started over. But, and then, you know, the mechanical engineers worked a lot on how this works and making it durable.
Mm-hmm. Very cool.
Yeah. Let's go over here. That's
awesome.
Now the playfields are married to cabinets, and you can see there's, you know, there's an Iron Man.
Right.
There's some medievals over there. Some Star Trek's getting ready to go. There's even some...
Yeah, tell me about those events. It's like a home model?
That's our home model. And
that's cute.
Yeah.
Is this like a Costco, Sam's Club type thing, or
right? This is this was, and these are prototypes that are back here.
But oh, it is.
Yeah, these are early prototypes, and so this was the intention was to make a low cost, you know, game, sort of an entry level game and this is missing a bunch of stuff. You can see here's a Transformers version. Mm-hmm. And an Avengers version.
So it's the full playfield, just without the DMD and some rule changes.
And it's simpler.
Yeah.
It's much simpler than the original game. Here, let's look at some of these. I wanted to show you this, so you can see
Poland.
This is going to Poland.
Taiwan.
You see that? Poland, Taiwan.
It says here coin mech. Does that mean you have to modify the coin mech to accept their local currency?
That's correct.
Is that right?
That's correct. So USA, Walking Dead.
Yep.
USA, Walking Dead.
Norwegian.
Yep. Norway.
Yep. Switzerland, France.
Yep. Here's a Metallica LED going to the USA. This guy's going to France. This guy's going to Austria. This guy is Swiss. This guy is Swiss.
Very cool.
That is the coolest thing. It's just, you know.
It's crazy. Yeah. Italy, I mean, it's just... Besides the U.S., who is
USA,
the biggest market?
Italy,
is it like Germany?
Western Europe?
Australia's
huge.
Yeah. Is it?
Australia's huge, yeah. Australia's a huge pinball community. Our distributor, the AMD, is just an absolute top-notch partner.
Mm-hmm.
Those guys do a tremendous job of, you know, hosting tournaments, and they do a great job at servicing their customers. And they've just been really instrumental in growing the world market in pinball. I can't say enough about those guys. They're really, really...
Wow, just kicking butt, huh?
Yeah. So, you can see, I mean...
Will these games get shipped onesie-twosie like that? Or,
no.
Or they go to like,
so
LCL?
Go,
or
so here's one going to Germany.
Yeah.
Here's another one going to Italy.
Mm-hmm.
So what happens is that a lot of times games are waiting for a container because... Uh-huh. A customer has ordered a container load of games, and he's ordered a mixed container. So he'll want I want 20 Star Treks, I want 15 Game of Thrones.
I see. So, you wait till they're all done.
Yeah. So you wait until you have his container ready to go.
Right.
And then you ship it.
I gotcha.
It's less of an issue domestically. You know, like so games going to the USA. Typically get shipped more or less, you know, it's like a regional thing, right? You know, okay, when the guy going to the East Coast shows up,
right,
all the East Coast games are going, right? But the Western Europe, the rest of the world, those games have to sort of wait for containers because they go into, you know, they go overseas, they go into a container, and they get put in a container ship and
Shipped
across the ocean, right? So these guys are doing, they do a final clean. There are certain things that they do here, like they put, you know, they'll put the back glasses in them. They'll do, they put certain components like coin doors, the right cord, all the stuff that, you know, that the game needs, the glass, they get cleaned up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they get a final cleaning. And then, you know, they get all the packaging materials. All the packaging materials for every game are a little bit different. Sometimes we need get out of the way. Sometimes, you know, we need like a special piece of foam or something to keep a device from moving. So all that stuff gets made here. And then see here, that game just went into its box.
Oh, that was cool how they put it in.
Yep. You'll see another one, and then they put all the packing material in the box and seal it up, and there it goes.
Awesome.
And so, then, so at that end, we haven't seen it yet. We'll make our way back there. I missed a whole area of the company where have incoming material control.
Okay.
So I kind of dove into the assembly lines And also, we have to go back there. I'll show you some of the cables and stuff.
Cool.
So,
can I ask you a question about the hardware platform?
Yes.
Because when I was at Southern Fried Gamer Max, I saw the KISS, and it had a little tiny little.
That's the new hardware.
Okay.
Yeah.
And this is still old.
The White Star, or whatever it's called.
Sam.
Yeah, it's called Sam.
Yeah.
And so, are you in
a transitional period right now with that?
Well, it's just that if we made a game that was native to Sam, we
stays
keep it on Sam.
Yeah. Okay.
And so games from a certain point on.
Yeah.
Are the new hardware.
And I noticed that new hardware that the LEDs for the back glass.
Yeah, they're right on there.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
I'm looking at it, I'm like, are you kidding me?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, it totally works.
It's the state of the world, right?
Right.
It's the state of the world.
But it
smaller.
Works.
Yeah, yeah. That new hardware is pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It does a lot. It's got way more horsepower than this system.
Right.
And it's very flexible.
Mm-hmm.
It scales, it's modular, so it scales up with the complexity of the games.
Okay.
So
is KISS the first game to use that platform?
No, I believe, I want to say WWE might have been the first game on that platform.
Game of Thrones is using that now?
Oh, yeah, Game of Thrones is using it.
But Star Trek's still on the old one.
Star Trek was still the old platform.
Okay.
So now we're going to go, I want to show you some of the cabinet stuff. He's doing functional sets. So this is, this is the cabinet line.
Mm-hmm.
Let's walk the cabinet.
They put the artwork on here?
Here, there's the new, that's the new system.
See, Greg, take a look at this. So that's the new board.
Yeah.
And you notice there's no like
It replaced all that stuff that was in that other back box.
Wow.
Gets a switching power supply. It doesn't have a huge giant transformer at the bottom.
Right, okay. What I thought was so interesting, though, is that there's no fluorescent light or anything because there's just LEDs on that board.
Right.
That's it?
LEDs
yeah.
on
yeah.
board?
Yeah. yeah.
That's them right there. See those tiny LEDs?
That's what lights the backglass up.
They light the entire backglass. Yep.
Man.
Isn't that crazy?
That's awesome.
I don't know why. I was just struck by that when I saw it.
It's the cabinet. This is one of the old system cabinets. You can see the big giant transformer. That's no longer in the game.
And are the decals applied here or at your cabinet maker?
We're gonna
okay.
It. Yep. So these are all, looks like these are all Star Trek. So we put these on just to protect the decal as it's going down the line. But typically, we're not putting on, it doesn't look like we're putting on decals today.
But they're applied in this area?
Yeah, they're applied in this area. So you see a bunch of cabinets that are staged.
Mm-hmm.
Here, let's go this way.
Jeez.
You were asking me about the bottom arches. Here's some red ones.
Okay.
Right? So they're not always the same. They're not always the same. Okay, so this is incoming inspection. We do a lot of, whenever possible, we have the vendor inspect and certify his parts.
Right.
We still take a look at stuff when it comes in here to make sure that...
Right, to do your own QC.
If a part is bad and you put a lot of labor into that part, it's a big waste when you find it at the other end of the line.
Right, yeah, you want to catch it now.
Yeah, so you want to catch it up front. So these guys basically do a lot of the inspection.
And reject some stuff too.
Yep, reject some stuff, send some stuff back to the vendors. They've got, a series of tools, and this is, just a lot of powder coat references that we've used in the past.
Oh, I see.
Things. So when stuff comes out, so after parts come out of here, they go into the stock room. This is all incoming material right here. This is all this stuff is incoming material that it has to eventually, end up in the stock room. After it's been checked.
It goes here and
goes in here.
Gets organized.
Yeah. Everything stored and sorted by what it is.
Mm-hmm.
And so this stock room essentially feeds the assembly line. So all the stuff that you know, for the assembly line, we'll go to the work cells from here.
Gotcha. It's funny, I see the Mattel boxes up there, the action figures.
Yep. That's probably what some toy we bought, right, that we couldn't make.
Right. Because there's stories, right, of you guys like going to like Walmart or stuff, yep. Some right, and, yeah, and buying all the toys up, the figures.
When, you know, certainly when we prototype.
Yeah.
You know. So, yeah, now we've got those areas over there. We've yet to grow into them.
Okay.
So we have some material stores, but you can see, there's decals. There's mm-hmm. some, this is all stuff coming in for different games, right?
Right.
Some Mustangs.
Yep. Ready to go in the cabinet.
Yep.
That's cool.
You can see some Game of Thrones stuff. I mean, it's really, that's one of the coolest things about our company is this ability to switch in and out of product
mm-hmm.
and build different things. Let's go look at the cable department.
So is this expanded from your old facility?
Our old warehouse? Yeah, to give you an idea, so our old facility was 45,000 square feet, so it would fit. Two of the old facility would fit inside this building.
And you guys already filled it up.
Double up on stations then, since you have more room now.
Yeah, so we have two full lines, and we have, when you say two full lines, you also need twice the sub-assembly areas to feed those two full lines.
Right.
You can see some black cabinets over there. Those are all, you know, those have been received, and they're, you know, waiting for decals.
So your capacity's doubled?
Pretty much.
Yeah.
I mean, I think it's probably more than doubled.
Really?
You know, because I think that space doesn't necessarily equate to,
right.
But it's a big help.
Yeah.
Right? So here's, this is the cable area, and you can see, yep. All the different crimping tools, depending on what we're making.
There's Buffett's crimpers.
There's
an inside joke.
lots of cables.
So they make all the wire, the harnesses here.
Yeah.
Oh, this is cool. These little Molex pin.
Yep. Yeah, some harnesses.
That's
come
awesome.
In from outside, you know, some harnesses come in from outside, depending on the complexity of the harness,
okay.
Or like perhaps we don't have tooling that's required.
Gotcha.
You know, but.
Check this out. This thing's putting the Molex crimp pins on there.
Yeah.
I need one of those. Put that in my garage. So this is the jig to make.
Board,
okay.
You know, yeah.
To make the harness.
So yeah, to make the harness. So they're all labeled.
I gotcha.
We store them. So whenever a game goes back on a line, the appropriate nail boards get pulled out. Here's the sample.
That's really cool how you make the harness,
oh,
you know?
Yeah.
It's like you look at it, you're like, how did someone make this? It's so perfect.
And then here, I mean, look at these, right? So these are all, here's
crazy.
Here's the Star Trek coil harness. Some more, you know, see these, all these, let's see, the Thrones cabinet harnesses. Look at all these harnesses. I mean,
it's just crazy.
Right?
So much manual labor.
Here, these guys are doing decals.
Oh, so nice.
Cabinets come in from the outside. They get touched up.
Okay.
Anything that's an issue, these guys work it.
So there's a little filler in here.
Yep.
There's a gouge or something. Yep.
Yep. Filling and sanding. Try to make it as smooth as possible for the decal application.
Bondo.
And they do use Bondo.
Do they use Bondo?
Yeah.
Nice. No thing about Bondo.
Yeah.
Some more cabinets. Getting ready to, you know, this is how they come in from the cabinet house with, you know, protected corners wrapped up.
So are these pretty generic for your,
most games use the same cabinet.
Okay.
There's a difference between a medieval cabinet, which is the old, a variation of the old Williams cabinet.
Okay.
And the Stern cabinet. But yeah, most games use the same cabinet. We consider the cabinet, the back box, the platform.
Okay.
And so
gotcha.
The platform gets, you know, gets reused.
So George,
the new back box is really kind of interesting. It's all sheet metal. Gets powder coated. It's not wood anymore.
Really? The whole thing or just the top?
All of the back and all of this.
It's sheet metal.
It's all sheet metal. Really? You can see it, right? It
comes kidding.
And we get in with all the PEMs. It comes in and it's perfect.
Right? That's awesome. And then the sides are wood.
The sides are wood. And the sides get, you know, attached to it with inserts.
That's interesting.
Let's see if I can find...
Makes a lot of sense. So George, you were saying that you consider this the platform, right? This form factor. Have you guys played with changing the platform? You know,
there's a lot of so what's interesting is we're constantly evolving it.
Right.
I mean, you're going to see you're going to see more improvements very soon.
Right. Right.
But we're constantly evolving it. There's a lot of things that this does that are not obvious to the untrained eye.
Right.
So, I mean, this has to do so much. It has to be, the games have to be serviceable.
Mm-hmm.
They have to exist in a very rugged environment, or a variety of rugged environments, right? So it's like, when they're in your house, you're not going to abuse your own games.
Right, but when it's at a bar,
when it's on a street, you never know what's going to happen.
Right.
Right? So they have to protect the money, so they have to be fairly rugged.
Mm-hmm.
They have to sustain the street environment, which mm-hmm. has always been incredibly rigorous.
Right.
They have to pass UL and FCC. You know, we can't ship anything that's not UL approved or mm-hmm. FCC. And so compliant.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of things that, like, people go, why did they change that? Well, sometimes it was a regulation.
Right.
Sometimes it was something like, you know, we couldn't make it, you know, through some requirement unless we mm-hmm. shortened this cable or put this here. In addition to that, they have to, you know, somebody has to be able to work on the thing. We have to be able to manufacture it.
Right,
you know,
right.
That's very significant.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end of the day, we're a business. It has to cost a certain amount of money in order for us to make enough money to stay in business and make more games.
Yeah.
So it's a whole series of requirements that are not always obvious. If I had unlimited funds, probably it wouldn't look this way.
Right.
If I didn't have to exist in all those environments. You know, the other thing about the form factor is the size of those boxes is optimized to take advantage of a container.
Right.
It's a shipping container.
Right.
So it's like, if I say, okay, I'm going to make the back box that much deeper.
It screws up the whole CBM.
It might throw the whole thing. right. And so all of the games, every game change that we do, the cabinet gets drop tested at a professional,
mm-hmm.
Engineering firm that does drop testing and container testing, right?
Yeah.
So it doesn't make it bulletproof. There's still, I mean, if you take the box and you push it off the back of your dock, it may survive or it may not.
Right.
You know, but it's designed to make it as livable and durable as it possibly can.
Right.
So it's a variety of different things that have to come
into
play. How it folds, how it goes in a box, how many boxes we get in a container.
Sure. I guess what I was getting at was more of a big picture question, more like, you know, pinball evolving and changing the form factor, you know, it's been that for a long time.
Yes.
And I'm just, you know, have you guys really tried to go far away from it? You know,
we've been all over. We've been all over. I mean, we're going to have an LCD very soon.
Yeah.
And you'll see some minor changes to the form factor to accommodate the LCD.
Yeah.
You know what I tell my designers? The game is under the glass. It's about the ball and the flippers.
Right.
The ball and the flippers
That's
are
interesting.
Sacred.
Yeah.
The ball and the flippers are sacred. You can change almost anything else. You can do almost anything else. The games are going to be online. The games are going to have an LCD. The games are going to do a lot.
Oh, they're going to be online. That's cool.
Yeah, they're going to be online. They're going to do a lot. But we have to, at the end of the day, it is still a pinball machine. It's really why we're enjoying, you know, we're enjoying the renaissance that we're enjoying because there's a generation of people that are discovering pinball for the first time.
Right.
They're, you know, we've all got virtual in our pockets. We've got virtual at work on our desktops.
Mm-hmm.
We entertain ourselves virtually in 15 different ways at home, you know, streaming this and downloading that. And, you know, we've got all of this. We've got tablets and computers. And this is a very visceral experience playing pinball. You know, it's a very different experience.
Right. Very analog.
My gravity is not a function of a number generator. My gravity
is gravity.
My gravity is gravity.
Right.
You know? So my randomness is not generated by a computer. My randomness is a function of gravity.
Right.
Right. And the first rule of pinball is keep the ball in play. After that, we build on that. Right. Mm-hmm. Okay. So now you know how to keep the ball in play. Now let's teach you how to make a shot.
Yeah.
Now let's teach you how to work the medium to tell the story. We in some ways, we're no different than any other entertainment medium. You know, when film got sound, that entertainment medium as a storytelling medium changed, right? And as every technology that's been introduced to it has evolved that, and the same thing with video games, and the same thing with our mediums to a certain extent, but at the end of the day, ball and flipper.
Right, that's the game.
Yeah, that's the game.
Yep.
Let's go.
This is cool. You see this, Greg? It comes with this can.
That?
Yeah. Because Greg Frere was telling me that everyone of these comes with this crushed can.
Yeah.
And then
crushed
there's an uncrushed one in the coin box.
Yep. Yep.
Right.
Yeah. We ship an empty uncrushed one in the coin.
Isn't that cool?
We have a lot of, all the stuff that we talk about, right? At the end of the day, the guys making games are all trying to have fun.
Right.
They're all fans of the hobby. They're all fans of the medium.
Right.
They're fans of the genre. They want to make games they want to play.
Exactly.
And that's really the deal. I mean, we've always, I would love to tell you that I make my decisions based on a focus group.
Right.
To me, that focus group might be a reference point, but I'm really going to try to make the game I want.
Yes.
The game I want to have fun playing.
That's great. That's good to hear.
So now I'm going to show you the click and bang room. Get your ears
click
ready.
Click and bang?
Yeah. So this is testing.
Oh, cool.
This is functional test, right? So these games. So there's a game. This game is playing itself.
No kidding.
Just to see what wears out.
Really?
Yep. Now it's probably got, see this? It's the wear fixture number one. It's got all the cycles on it. Look how dirty that field is.
So was there a ball in there?
There was. And so I don't, right now he may be testing just a flipper.
No kidding, that's crazy.
Look at this.
The shaker motors just go over and over.
Yep.
Wow.
Until they self-destroy. This is testing something.
Look at that.
So every one of these things, and they'll go 24/7.
Yeah.
And we just run them till failure, and we learn a lot.
Yeah.
We learn a lot about what's going on.
That is awesome. It's kind of spooky in here.
Yeah.
Hey, check this out, Greg.
Yeah, it's hard to. Those are mine. I just brought them in.
Are they? Hey, tell us. We want to try to link ours over the internet.
Yeah.
Think we can pull it off? We're gonna do it.
Good luck with that.
Really? Can you give us any tips?
Is it a serial connection between the two?
These are. See, this is entirely intended to confuse you. The cafeteria sign.
That's funny.
Product development.
I like that.
Yeah. Camouflage.
That's funny.
Don't go in the cafeteria. Okay, and then this area, remember we saw the other area was the stock room, right?
Okay.
And this is the parts department. So
okay.
This services customers. So,
oh, I see.
Like when a customer calls up and he says, hey, I wore out this part, or I need another one of these, or I bought a game.
Consumers?
And it's missing. Yes.
Okay.
So I bought a game and it's missing this, He would call his, he would call his distributor would call up.
I see. Okay.
And then we would send it out of here. So you can see here, let's go.
And you guys are kind of getting into these kind of accessories, like aftermarket stuff?
So the accessory line has been very successful for us. The accessory line is one of those things where we're trying to do accessories that are interactive with the game, and they're plug and play. They're absolutely top-notch fit and finish. There's no holes to be drilled.
Right.
Nothing. You know, you basically buy it.
Right.
You put it on your game. You plug it in, and we design the software to be interactive.
So this is like DLC.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Exactly. Exactly. Yep. Lots of, you know, sometimes the guy, see all those toppers going out.
And do you sell those direct to consumers or is it, oh, you do?
Yep. When you wear out a play field and you need another one, you know, this is where it would come from.
Okay.
Right, so there's Star Trek, let's see what we got here, Transformers. Avengers. These are brand new playfields.
Wow, that's great.
Stored to go back. You know, here's AC/DC.
So these are here for replacement parts for consumers or a Wheel of Fortune?
Yep.
You have a Whirlwind? I need a Whirlwind.
The Shrek.
Wow.
Right, let's see what we got here.
Wheel of Fortune. Indiana.
Oh my God, look at that. Yeah. Indiana Jones.
That's cool.
Yep. So this is really no different than the parts department at your Chevy dealer.
Yeah.
Right? It's the same kind of thing. You know, he's got a bunch of bins. You go in there and you say, I need an oil filter.
Right, and the guy goes in the back and gets it.
This is technical services. These guys, Pat and Chaz, basically, they will take your calls when, like, you call up and you say, "Hey, I'm having this issue. Mm. I don't know what it is."
Right.
Or, you know, they'll help you troubleshoot the games.
Interesting.
They do some amount of here. Let's go in here.
Okay.
Hey guys, I'm the.
Hi.
So they do some amount of repair. And sometimes if we're having some kind of an issue, they help us troubleshoot it. But, you know, and then, of course, they'll take your calls. They've got some test fixtures dating back to various iterations of Stern hardware. And they've really become experts in all the different hardware that we've produced over the years.
Awesome.
Let's come through to here. Reference mechanisms. Every once in a while, you know, he has to look up, you know, how did we do something?
Right.
A customer has some issue.
Right. A guy would call up and say, AC/DC is doing this, and he can just look at it.
Yep. You see all the different, you know, lots of different toys, stuff from all these different games.
Sometimes it's easier to look at those than a drawing.
Is that?
Yeah. Yep.
Makes sense.
So, I mean, that's generally, let's go, let's see, I think Gary, I don't know if Gary's here, you guys.
So that's it.
So, there's some cool stuff in here.
Yeah, we popped in here earlier. We didn't know what we were looking at exactly.
This is Gary Stern's office. And so, you know, and what's cool about this is there's lots of, you know, reference to, you know, lots of different, you know, the history of pinball sort of thing.
Right. Old replays.
And, you know, pictures of, you know, there's, that's Gary and his father, you know, that's Harry Williams. So, you know, I mean, it's like, and some magazine covers from back in the day.
Yeah.
So.
Very cool.
Yeah.
So, George, is that it?
I think that's it.
I think we did it all.
You got everything except product development, which I can't let you in.
Understandable.
And so, I think you have a pretty good pretty good picture of.
Well, that was really awesome.
Of who we are and what we do, how we do it. Really cool. You know.
So I have to ask you a question. So, what's your favorite video game that you worked on?
Okay.
Because you worked on a lot of video games, right?
I did.
Prior to pinball?
Yeah, I did. You know, it's hard to say. I have a soft spot for the two that I'm most known for, Tron and Spy Hunter.
Okay.
You know, Spy Hunter I had a lot of fun with, and so I would say maybe Spy Hunter.
Spy Hunter?
Yeah.
And you did like the joysticks and stuff, like for Satan's Hollow and Tron.
Yeah,
I did a bunch of,
so you know, when I started in the business, the very first things I did were like themed cabinets and control systems for games. And then I really wanted to make games, and so at some point in time I partnered up with a guy who was a programmer, and him and I started, you know, doing games. And that was that era. You know, that was Satan's Hollow and Tron,
right?
And Spy Hunter, and so. And then I did console stuff. Many years later, I worked on the NBA Ballers series.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, yeah. And with some really famous guys, Mark Trammell.
Okay.
And, you know, the NBA, father of NBA Jam. And
right, right.
Blitz and stuff. And so Mark and I worked a lot on that, you know, for like 9 years of my life. It was a long time to work on a basketball game.
Yeah. 9 years.
Yeah. Yeah. But, yeah, so, you know, I mean, I'm old, so I've been doing this a long time.
Yeah, yeah. Well, we're big fans.
Thank you.
Him and I both have Fast Break, and we love it.
Yeah.
I'm serious. I love that game.
I have a story, actually.
Can I tell you it?
Sure.
So I used to live in Palatine, and when my wife and I were dating, she used to listen to Q101 every morning.
Yes.
And they gave away an NBA Jam on Q101. Okay. Do you remember this at all?
No.
Okay, I was hoping you did.
No.
She went on the radio station,
oh, really?
And she had to beat like two other guys.
Oh, really?
And they picked three listeners, and I made her train at Dave and Buster's over, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And I made her, I'm like, you are going to win this game, right? And this is well before I had any games.
That's awesome.
We were just in an apartment in Palatine. And so she trained and she got really good at NBA Fast Break and she came in second place.
Oh.
This guy won. He was a ringer. He had the stance, you know. And so years later, I'm like, I'm getting that game. We're going to get that game eventually. And so we did. And it's been in my collection for like 8 years.
That game, when I did that game,
yeah.
It was not that well received. It was a very controversial game because of the way that I chose to do the score.
But that's the best part of it.
Ball scoring. Okay,
yeah. That's why we like
it. I had like a lot of resistance even from the Williams Engineering Group at the time. You know, everybody was like, oh, you know, it's like a novelty game.
Right.
And nobody liked it. And now it's what's interesting is all of these all the beer kids have discovered Linked Fast Break,
uh-huh.
which was way ahead of its time.
Right.
Way too far ahead of its time. Nobody knew what the hell to do with it.
Right.
And now all of a sudden I'm a genius. All these years, and I was like, where were you guys in 1996?
Right, right. Yeah, it's an awesome game, and RFM, and you only have NBA Fast Break of his, right?
Is that, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
So awesome.
That's good.
Yeah, good game.
I love it. I mean, you know, for me, satisfaction comes from guys appreciating the work. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I was saying, you know, I love to do it. If I think it's cool, then that's what I'm gonna do.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes I'm right, sometimes I'm wrong. I guarantee you this: I work just as hard. I put as much of myself in the ones that you guys hate as in the ones that you guys love.
Right.
So that's the deal.
Awesome. All right, guys. Well, George.
Yep.
He's Greg.
George.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate
the time. That was amazing. That was the best tour ever.
All right, guys. That's it. That was our tour of Stern Pinball.
That was crazy.
Hey, awesome. Steve Ritchie.
How's it going? Hi, Steve.
What's up? How are you doing?
Steve Ritchie just walked out. So anyway, that was freaking awesome. George Gomez is amazing. And Steve Ritchie's cool, too.
That was visual overload. I didn't know what to say.
You didn't know
what
was going on?
This is cool. I love that. So,
you know, all of that factory touring has made me really hungry.
You know what?
You want to get some food?
We're in Chicago. We have the best pizza. We have the best hot dogs.
All right, where we go? Let's go.
Let's just go. First place, go.
So you ready for food?
I am. You know,
Portillo's is right here,
yeah.
Which is a kind of a hot dog, famous hot dog
and
place.
It's really famous for Italian beef.
And I think it's not the best hot dog, but it's one of the better Italian beefs.
One of the better Italian beefs.
Yes.
That's for sure.
Yeah,
no
it's a good hot dog.
Yeah. That's,
but they're Italian beefs? It's kind of a standard, I think. So why don't we go in there, let's get an Italian beef. What do you think?
Let's see how this unfolds.
But, you know, Portillo's are all over Chicago.
Yeah, we have one in Rockford now.
Oh, you do?
We do.
It's funny, though, because when I was in California with Craig, we went to Portillo's in Southern California.
Yeah, what is that city it's in?
The guy that owns Portillo's has a home down there.
Yeah, Dick.
Dick Portillo. All right, Greg, so here it is.
Okay.
This is your kind of definitive Chicago Italian beef sandwich,
feels
right?
Feels pretty firm still.
And we decided to get the gravy or au jus, the kind of, it's like a beef broth on the side.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the options is for them to take the entire sandwich and just submerge it in that sauce.
Yep.
And that's how my grandpa used to make it.
You can order these dry, standard, or wet.
Exactly. And you know, I grew up in an Italian family in Chicago, and this was like when you have a birthday party, or it like my mom would be like, oh, we'll have Italian beef. You know, that was like that's what we served to guests at a party, you know?
Sure.
And my parents, my grandpa made homemade jardinière, which is what this pepper mix is.
Mm-hmm.
And I love jardinière.
Oh, yeah.
I put it on pasta. And so this is your classic kind of Chicago French bread. Because like on the East Coast, I can't find bread like this.
Really?
Yeah, I can't. Like to make a nice sandwich.
Yeah.
And so you have your pepper mix, you have your beef,
mm-hmm.
which, look at that.
That looks pretty nice.
Oh man, that is so good.
Okay, so let's cook this up. And,
should we do this?
Yeah, I think we should.
So, all right, Greg, you go first. I want you to enjoy it. I want to watch you
that looks pretty good.
Enjoying this.
Okay, so.
Come on. And by the way, I'm blowing my low-carb diet, obviously. I have to do it when I'm in Chicago. What do you think? Oh, really?
There's a lot of flavor there. That juice is not just water. That is strong meat. Strong meat juice. I don't know
it
how
is.
To describe that.
It is meat. They should sell it, like, in a bottle.
Yeah.
Like, with a straw.
Oh, my God.
I love the peppers.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't it make it? That is so good.
Even though we soaked it, the bread still has that consistency that you need. That
little crispiness that, you know, there's a little excitement when you... It's not just like...
It's just got that mushiness, firm, soaking so, juices.
So, yeah, that is excellent.
Yeah.
Definitely recommend the Italian beef.
Portillo's, I mean, out of 10, what do you rate that?
I mean, for Italian beef, it's damn near perfect. I mean,
yeah, I say it's about a 9.
I would say 9, 9.5.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't know how you could get any better, to be honest.
No, I agree.
Right.
Yeah.
So Portillo's. All right, Greg, we gotta get out of here.
Yeah. We gotta go. Next.
All right, let's hit the road.
All right.
Greg, this is it.
It's a good day.
We made it through another holiday video spectacular.
Yeah.
Is that what we're calling this?
I think, yeah, now we are.
Right. But we did a lot. So, hey, buddy, good hanging out with you.
Man. See you. Let me give you a bro hug.
Yeah. So, drive safe.
Nice.
I'll see you very soon at BroFest number 2.
BroFest 2.
June.
John's Arcade Impossible.
John's Arcade Impossible Outsiders, June 3rd and
4th. 2016.
Yes. Right. So
make sure to book your
cabin at nastwood.com.
Just use code
BroFest.
Code BroFest. This is true. So.
And that's what I count.
That's and it. Here we are. We never went into GameWorks, by the way. We're kind of drawn to this place, but we just didn't go in.
This is our third year doing this.
Right.
3 years.
I know.
Meeting up Thanksgiving week.
Yeah. So. We got to do it again next, so. All right, man.
All right.
Love you.
Yeah.
All right, guys, let's go back to the basement. So that, of course, was part number two of our 2015 Chicago Arcade Adventure Series. And what'd you guys think? Amazing, right? It was absolutely amazing. I mean, can you believe that we took a tour of the Stern Pinball Factory? And to top it all off, George Gomez was our tour guide. Unbelievable. So, of course, we have to thank everybody. You know, I have to thank everyone at Stern because they are super nice and super accommodating. And, of course, we have to thank George Gomez for taking time out of his day to give us a tour. Unbelievable. And really, I got to tell you, that place was nice. It was a very clean and big factory. I had no idea that that many people were involved in making pinball machines in 2015. I mean, really, my perception of the company is way different now. So that was awesome. Really awesome. And thanks again to George Gomez and everybody at Stern. So, and of course, thanks to Greg, you know, my buddy Greg. I love hanging out with Greg. And you guys should go to his check out his videos. Go on YouTube and search for Arcade Impossible and be sure to watch his videos. And he will be releasing his own version of this week. Okay, you know, this is my part two, but he'll be releasing his own I don't know if he's doing one or two videos, but I know he's going to do one of Stern for sure, and then probably one of Logan Hardware as well. So be sure to go to Arcade Impossible to see his side of the day. So it was a lot of fun. I really like going to Chicago and doing these videos with Greg. This is our third year in a row doing this, and it's a blast. And they're getting more fun and better every year. So who knows what we'll do next year? So stay tuned because I want to do this every year forever. So, all right, so let's do some viewer mail here. And by the way, if you guys want to participate in the viewer mail, you need to email them to me at blkdog7@gmail.com. That's blkdog7@gmail.com. That's blackdog7@gmail.com. In the subject line, you got to put viewer mail. Otherwise, I will not find it. And actually, someone asked me, they said, John, I don't understand. Why can't you find the mail if it doesn't say viewer mail in the subject line? I'm going to tell you why. Because before I do these videos, I go into my email and I search by subject line viewer mail. Okay, that's how I sort them, okay? And so if the subject line is not viewer mail, it does not show up in my search, okay? So that's why I ask that you put viewer mail in the subject line, two words, okay? Viewer and mail, and that's M-I-L, not M-A-L-E, and put that in the subject line, and then I could go into my email and just search for viewer mail, and it gives me a nice list, and I can just go down and print them out. So, all right, anyway, all right, let's do a few here. First one is from Justin. Hey, John, I know that much of your collection is the older 1980s era games like Pac-Man, Donkey Kong, etc., but I do see that you have some modern style cabinets. I'm currently trying to scratch build a Dynamo HS5 Street Fighter 2 cab, and I have pretty much everything but the physical cabinet, the monitor, and the game PCB. I do have an OEM HS5 power supply made by HAP, okay? He says, what I'm wondering is how to wire up the cabinet to make use of the power supply. as the on-off switch for the cabinet will be pushed in when the power supply is installed. Are there any additional fuses or transformers or areas that the AC power has to go through from the power supply's Molex connector, or does it get plugged directly into the monitor? If so, how are the marquee lights lit? Online, there's plenty of information about older games, but nothing in regards to modern generic cabs. Any help would be appreciated. Many thanks, Justin. Justin, you know, really, it's the same. Honestly, it is. The older games, the newer games, it's all the same. The only thing that really changed was later on, monitors stopped requiring isolation transformers, because all of the 80s monitors required isolation transformers. And then at some point in the 90s and beyond, they stopped requiring the isolation transformer on the bottom. Now, if you're not sure if your game or monitor needs an isolation transformer, I say still use one. But anyway, the wiring, the AC wiring and all that is really the same, old or new, okay? It's all the same idea. And actually, I printed out something here, and we'll go through it. And I got this from Bob Roberts' website. And Google this. Just Google Bob Roberts AC wiring, because he really breaks it down in a really easy-to-understand way. But we'll go through this together, okay? And I printed out this diagram, okay? But this is your basic wiring right here, okay? And you got your outlet, your plug right here, coming in with your AC, okay? Now, in between here and here is where your switch is gonna be, okay? So what you wanna do is you wanna put all of this stuff after the switch, okay? The AC switch, because you're gonna have to add the AC switch if you don't have one, okay? So basically, you want a switch that's gonna turn off the AC coming into this stuff, okay? So the power's coming in, okay? And then it goes through a fuse right here, okay? And by the way, this is all on Bob Roberts' website, okay? It goes through a fuse holder, and then it goes into a AC line filter, okay, right here. And this is your very basic setup you'll see on every game, okay? So the power comes through the cord, through a fuse into the AC line filter. And then what Bob has here, this right here is an AC distribution block or tabs, okay? And on here is where you're gonna tap into everything, okay? So on this AC distribution block, you're gonna tap in your isolation transformer, which again, Bob Roberts sells, okay? So the isolation transformer is getting its AC from here, and then this power would then go to your monitor, okay? On the other side, or on these two top tabs, okay? And then the power supply right here is also tapped into the AC distribution block, okay? So that's how the power supply is getting its AC. It's tapped in right here, okay? Now, this is a power supply that converts AC voltage to DC voltage, okay? So the power that comes out of this power supply is DC voltage. This is for the logic board, okay? This is for your game PCB. So your 5 volts, your 12 volts, your minus 12, your 5 volts, your minus 5, and your 12 volts, if your game PCB requires all of those, will come from here. Now, coin door lights, you could do a couple ways. You could tap them in here on the 12 volts or the 5 volts and run that to the coin door. But your marquee lights, you're gonna wanna tap in right here on your AC distribution, because the marquee light is gonna be an AC fluorescent light fixture, okay? So you wanna tap in right here. Now, on the older games, they would have a transformer here that would output multiple voltages, okay? So you'd have two tabs that are like 110 for the monitor, and then there might be two tabs that are 12 volts AC for the coin door, all right, for the coin door bulbs. So the new ones are 1-to-1. So the new isolation transformers are 1-to-1, meaning it outputs the same voltages that go in. So you're gonna have 110, 120 going in, and then 110, 120 isolated going out, that goes to your monitor. So really, this is the setup you need. Isolation transformer for the monitor, power supply for your game board. Yours might not look like this. It could look like a PC style. They're all the same. It's just different form factor. Same idea, they're switching power supplies. And then the only other thing, so basically tap in your fluorescent light right here, and then if you're gonna use 12 volts for the coin door, you could tap in over here on your power supply and run that voltage to the coin door for the bulbs. So I hope that makes sense. And then your switch is gonna be over here before it comes into all this. So you're gonna have to add an AC switch that you could put in line between the cord and the fuse that will turn it all off. So does that make sense? Google this. Google Bob Roberts AC wiring. It's all the same. It really is. The only thing that changes is the power supply, you know. And the older games, they might be linear power supplies. They're grabbing AC voltages from the transformer, you know, maybe 20 or 30 volts that comes over here that then gets dropped down to 5. But on the newer ones, they take 110, the new switching power supplies, which is probably the same one you have. It takes 110 from here and then converts it down to AC, to DC. So I hope that explains it. But again, just Google Bob Roberts AC wiring. All right, so this one's from Tim Brannon, and you know, I got a lot of questions about my MAME cabinet, and I'm gonna tell you the truth too about this, because I built that MAME cabinet so long ago, and I researched a lot of stuff when I did that, but I forgot most of it. Like, I forgot all the little details, you know, like how I got Mala working. And so I'll try to help you, Tim, as best as I can. But I had a lot of people asking me how I got the MAME hooked up and how I did my Mala theme. But I did it so long ago, and I only did it one time, so I didn't retain a lot of that information. But I'm going to try to help you the best I can. Hey, John. I was watching your two videos about your favorite MAME games. By the way, you guys liked those videos. I think you guys did. I had a lot of positive comments about the MAME videos. And I would like to do more of those this winter. Anyway, hey John, I was watching your two videos about your favorite MAME games, and I had a few questions about your setup. I've been tinkering with setting up a MAME machine for a while. I have a gutted dynamo cabinet to put it into, but the part that I've been stumping that has been stumping me is hooking up an arcade monitor, okay? He says, which brand of monitor do you have in it, and how is it connected to the computer? Through a JPEG? How did you set up the resolutions? Have you considered doing a video showing the guts and demonstrating how you set it up? Yeah, we could do that. I haven't been back there in like 5-6 years, but we can do it. It's probably a mess. I'll probably be embarrassed if we go back there, because I wasn't as savvy back then. Anyway, I'm thinking I'm not the only one who might be interested. I tried using an arcade VGA board in a K7000, but could never get it to sync properly, and the image was always skewed or squished. I finally gave up and reconnected an old VGA 16x9 monitor. I have 5 dedicated machines, as well as an arcade SD, but sometimes the only way to play a game is through MAME. Okay, so let me show you guys. I'll explain the gist of what I did, and I remember the big picture here. So basically, the first thing I did was I converted my Pac-Man to a MAME cabinet with an adapter, okay? So essentially, my cabinet is wired JAMA, okay? I converted it to JAMA. And so I have a JAMA cabinet, and then what I did was I plugged the JAMA plug with an adapter into a JPEG. And when you do that, the video signal is going with you, okay? And so what you do, so this is the JPEG right here, and we'll try to remember how this works, but so this right here is the JAMA connector, okay? And that plugs into the JAMA harness, right? And so where you would normally plug a game PCB, you plug this thing instead. That's really what's going on, okay? So pretend this is your game PCB. You plug that into the JAMA harness, and then the video signals are all here, okay? And so the video signals are coming into here. Actually, it's going this way. So what you do is you plug, all right, let's back up. You plug your video card from your computer into here, right? The VGA plug right here, see that? You plug your video card from your computer into this, and now the video signals are coming out here on these tabs on this header, right? I mean, on the edge connector, right? So then you plug your JAMA harness into this, so the video now is coming out of here, and that's how it gets to the monitor, through here with your JAMA plug. But it needs to be 15K, right? The frequency, the refresh rate needs to be 15K, because these old arcade monitors are 15K. And so in order to make sure it's 15K, you need to install a driver for certain GeForce video cards that's called Soft 15, which is what I have on mine. So I just got myself a really generic and cheap GeForce video card. And if you go like on the BYOAC wiki, this is all documented. And it lists which video card Soft 15 works with, okay? So you get yourself one of the right video cards and you install the Soft 15 driver, and then it outputs a 15K video out of your computer into here, and then the monitor on the arcade game will then accept it properly and sync through here. So that's what I did. The other option is to get an arcade VGA board, which is way more expensive, and plug that into here. Now, I didn't use arcade VGA, so I don't really know the ins and outs of that. I'm telling you how I did it. And then what I did was I made sure that all the INI files had the right... There is a program that will generate all of the INI files for you, okay? And these little text files basically tell MAME what's the proper resolution for every single game. You know, some games are 220 by 3, whatever, and, you know, and so... If you have the INI files set up correctly, or you have it set to auto, it should all sync right, and things shouldn't be stretched. Now, I'm going to tell you something, though. My monitor was one of the later model Wells Gardeners, okay? That, I believe, had some kind of an auto sync thing going on. So I might have been helped a little bit. But I will tell you this, though, that my buddy Matt McCarthy used an old K4900 monitor with this, and the Soft 15 driver, he had no problems. So I know that this works. So I don't know, man. All I could tell you is this is what I did and it worked. And maybe someone else has some advice. But I remember that the secret was in those INI files, because I think that my pictures were squished or stretched. And then once I had the INI file set up correctly, I think most of them, if not all of them, just said like auto. Then it all worked fine, and that was like a critical step. So, I don't know, man. I hope I helped you, but that really is what I did, okay? All I did was I used Soft 15, I plugged my video card into here, and then my JAMA connector up here, and I know my buddy Matt McCarthy did the same exact thing, and it all just synced up and worked with him, so... you know, a lot of this stuff is really well documented on the BYOAC wiki and the Mala wiki. So, you know, if you have any more specific questions, ask them, and maybe people in the comments can reach out and give you some help too. If I'm overlooking something, which is entirely possible. Okay, so the next one here is from Tim. Actually, I already read that one. Let's see what else we got here. Oh, here we go. From Carl. It says, "Hey John, thank you for the birthday shout out last month. I was definitely not expecting that. Happy birthday, Carl. Belated. It was a nice surprise. I'd like to hear your opinion on buying an original dedicated Donkey Kong, which are going up every day. These games are in high demand and the prices keep going up and up and up, and it's getting crazy out there. But anyway, the seller approached me about the monitor needing repair. Typical cap kit overhaul. And I asked if he wanted to sell it as is when I told him what I thought the problem was, a wavy monitor and no sound. Could be B plus, but yes. Anyway, the price we agreed on is $600, which I thought was fair for both of us, considering that I can fix it myself, and he has no clue how to repair these games. Donkey Kong originals are hard to come by in Montana, and I know that I shouldn't let this one get away like others I have in the past. What do you think? I love all the stuff you do for all of us in the great hobby. Thank you very much for all your hard work, Carl." All right, Carl, so $600 for a Donkey Kong. You know what, man? These days, that's what it costs. That's a good price. Just do it. So, I mean, what would a better price be? $500? $400? What, are you going to wait a year or two to save $100? You know what? If you really want Donkey Kong, just do it. $600 is not outrageous. It's not these days. It's in line. It's good because they're going for a grand. They're going for $1,200. So $600, do it. Just do it. Do it. Do it. Just get it over with and get the game. Because if you're gonna try to save $100 or $200, you'll be sitting around for the next 4 years waiting for that to show up. So I say buy it. You know, and if the monitor's dead, I wouldn't freak out about that. You know, Sanyo 20 EZs are really easy to fix usually, and a lot of times if the monitor's dead, you just cap the whole thing and you replace all the caps, the hot and the flyback, and that usually brings them back to life. And then also adjust your B plus. And so it sounds like the whole monitor just might be dead. I you said it's a wavy picture. I don't know, but yeah, I would grab that. I would not hesitate to buy that for $600. You know, if you really want a Donkey Kong, and that's the deal that you found so far, I would grab it, because I don't think you're gonna do much better these days, because the price on those is going up and up and up, because everybody wants a Donkey Kong, because it's the greatest game ever, that's why. And it's Nintendo. So yes, I will never get rid of mine. I had two at one time, and I really missed the second one, because I had comfort knowing I had two of them, but I traded that for the Black Knight. But anyway, yeah, $600, do it. Do it, do it, do it. So anyway, guys, that's it for this video. I hope you guys enjoyed it. We are going to be in the garage again very soon. We are. So, and hey, you know, I want to tell you about my other YouTube channel, because I'm going to be ramping that up really soon here. It's called John Sucks at Video Games. It's a fun title, okay? And because I really do suck at most video games. But so far on that channel, I've been doing Let's Play videos. And I admit those are a bit vanilla and boring. And we're going to be doing some really cool stuff on that channel soon, starting with building a PC from scratch. Now, I went kind of crazy here over the Thanksgiving holiday, and I bought all of the parts, because I was actually waiting because I wanted to take advantage of all the Black Friday sales. And so on Thanksgiving Day at my parents' house, I was sitting there on Newegg just watching all the sales and waiting, and I had my parts list, and I ordered all of it. So that's going to be coming in the next week. And then I'm going to do like an introductory video to the channel in the next day or two. So if you guys want to see those and the format's going to be like this. You know, it's going to be analog like this in the basement, except instead of talking about this kind of stuff, we're gonna be talking about PCs and modern video games, but we're gonna do it in the basement. And if you like these videos, I guarantee you'll like it. It's gonna be fun. But so far, I've done the Let's Play videos, and I know that's vanilla and not very original. So we're gonna start doing the cool stuff now. So subscribe. If you go on YouTube, just search for John Sucks at Video Games, or on YouTube on the far right there, you can see on the top, there'll be a link to my new channel. And then of course, go to iankellogg.com and take advantage of his sale, his Cyber John Day sale, that will give you 20% off your entire order. You know, so if you guys want to stock up on cap kits, go to iankellogg.com November 30th, 2015 through December 4th, 2015. You got to use the coupon code Cyber John Day. That's right, Cyber John Day. It's all one word, Cyber John Day. And you'll get 20% off your entire order at iankellogg.com. So anyway, that's gonna do it for this video. I hope you guys enjoyed it. I'll see you guys very soon. And of course, check out my podcast, Video Game Outsiders at videogameoutsiders.com, and Arcade Outsiders at arcadeoutsiders.com. So that's it, guys. I hope you had a great Thanksgiving. I did. And of course, thanks again to my buddy Greg and George Gomez and Stern and oh, Time Runner. I didn't thank Time Runner. You know, Time Runner flew out from Texas and was my cameraman. I mean, how amazing. He made the video that much better. So thank you, Mark Shields, for coming out. I'm sorry I didn't thank you earlier in this video. What a stand-up guy. What an awesome guy. I was just kidding around with him in the John's Arcade forums, because, you know, Mark did my camera work at Grinker's, and he did such a great job. And I was just joking around. I'm like, yeah, Mark, you should come out to Chicago and you can be my cameraman when we go to Stern and Logan Hardwin. He's like, okay, I'll do that. And he booked a ticket and showed up. So he made this video series 70 times better. So it's making me realize, you know, I need to find a cameraman. I need to find someone local that wants to hang out with me on the weekends and do some videos, because I need to do that. That really makes the video so much better. So anyway, Mark Shields, Time Runner, you're an awesome dude. Thank you so much for coming out and helping me make this video that much better. You're an awesome dude, and I love hanging out with you, man. So yeah, and of course, thanks to Matt, another nice guy who's Greg's cameraman. So just a great day. So anyway, we're done. All right, so let's get out of here. So I hope you guys enjoyed it. I'll talk to you very soon. Subscribe, like, tell your friends, all that good stuff. Comment. So And if you want to support me, go on the homepage there. There's a donate button on my YouTube page. On the right, you can donate. I guess in Europe, you can do that now. And of course, I'll thank you. I know we want to go, but I should thank you guys, though, for supporting me on that t-shirt campaign, because again, we sold almost 300 t-shirts. So I have to thank you guys personally for doing that. You guys are just amazing. So thank you, thank you, thank you for the endless and continued support. You guys are just awesome. So, all right, that's it. We're really done now. So I'll see you guys very soon. Later, and bye.